Recorded Books and RB Digital present The Steel by S.M. Stirling and David Drake. Narrated by Franklin Pierson. Chapter 1. Tom Poplinich floated through infinity. The monoblock exploded outward, and he felt the twisting of space-time in its birth squall. I think I understand that now, he thought. Excellent, Center said. We will return to socio-historical analysis. Subject, Fall of the Federation of Man. He had been down here in the sanctum of Sector Command and Control Unit AZ-12/B-14/C-000-Mark-14 for years now. His body was in stasis, his mind connected with the ancient battle computer on levels far broader than the speech-like linkage of communication. It was no longer necessary for him to see events sequentially. Images drifted through his consciousness. Earth, the true Earth of the canonical handbooks, not this world of Bellvue. Yet it was not the perfect home of half-angels that the priests talked of, but a world of men. Nations rose and warred with each other. Empires grew and fell. Men learned as the cycle swung upward, then forgot, and fur-clad savages dwelt in the ruins of cities, burning their books for winter's warmth. At last, one cycle swung further skyward than any before. On a small island northwest of the main continent, engines were built. Ones he recognized at first, clanking steam engines, driving factories to spin cloth, dragging loads across iron rails, powering ships. The machines grew greater, stranger. They took to the air, and cities burned beneath them. They spread from one land to the next, springing at last into space. Earth floated before him, blue and white like the images of Bellvue that Center showed him. Blue and white like all worlds that could nourish the seed of Earth. One final war scarred the globe beneath him with flames, pinpoints of fire that consumed whole cities at a blow. Soundless globes of magenta and orange bloomed in airless space. The last jihad, Center's voice said. Observe. A vast construct drifted into view. Skeletal and immense beside the tubular ships and dot-tiny suited humans. The Tanaki Spatial Displacement Net, the first model. Energies flowed across it, twisting into dimensions describable only in mathematics that he had not yet mastered. The ships vanished, to reappear far away, here in Bellvue's system. The colonists, first men to set foot on this world. They landed and raised the green flag of Islam. Even more than the jihad, the net made the Federation of Man essential, Center said. The empire that rose this time expanded until it covered all the earth and leaped outward to nearby stars. A century later, its representatives landed on distant Bellvue, much to the displeasure of the descendants of the refugees, and the net was its downfall. Expansion proceeded faster than integration. Long strings of formulae followed. Once the tipping point was reached, entropic decay accelerated exponentially. The higher they rise, the harder they fall, Tom thought. True. There was a slight overtone of surprise in Center's dispassionate machine voice. More images, war flickering between the stars. Mutiny, secession. Bellvue's net flaring into plasma. The remnants of Federation units turning feral when they were cut off here, bringing civilization down in a welter of thermonuclear fire. Swift decay into barbarism for most areas. A pathetic remnant of ancient knowledge preserved in the civil government and the colony, degenerating into superstition. Now 1,000 years and more had passed, and a tentative rebirth stirred. Cycles within cycles, Center said. The overall trend is still toward maximum entropy, unless my intervention can alter the parameters. 15,000 years will pass until the ascendant phase of the next overall historical period. An image eerily familiar, for he had seen it with his own eyes as well as through Center's senses. Two young men out exploring the ancient catacombs beneath the governor's palace in East Residence. Unlikely friends. Tom Poplinich, grandson of the last Poplinich governor. A slight young man in a patrician's hunting outfit of tweed. Raj Whitehall, tall, with a swordsman's shoulders and wrists. Guard to the reigning Baron Claret. And like him, from distant Descott County. Source of the civil government's finest soldiers. Once again he saw them discover the bones outside the centrum. The bones of those Center had considered and rejected as its agents in the world. Raj will do it, Tom thought. If any man can reunite the world, he can. If any man can, Center agreed. The probability of success is less than 45% plus or minus 3, even with my assistance. He's already beaten back the colony. The Battle of Sanderol had been the greatest victory the civil government had won in generations. Destroyed the squadron. The squadron and its admirals had held the southern territories for more than a century, the most recent of the military governments to come down out of the barbarous base area. And he's beating the brigade. The 591st Provisional Brigade were the strongest of the barbarians, and they held Old Residence, the original seat of the civil government at the western end of the Midworld Sea. To date, Center acknowledged, he has taken the Crown Peninsula and Lion City. The more difficult battles remain. Men follow Raj, Tom said quietly. Not only that, he makes them do things beyond themselves. He paused. What really worries me is Baron Claret. He doesn't deserve a man like Raj serving him. And that nephew he sent along on this campaign is worse. Cabot Claret is more able than his uncle, and less a prisoner of his obsessions, Center noted. That's what worries me. Chapter 2. The cavalry were singing as they rode. The sound bawled out over the manifold thump of paws from the riding dogs, the creak of harness and squeal of ungreased wheels from the baggage train. Ah, we descutters have hairy ears, we goes without our breeches, and pops our cocks with jagged rocks. We're hardy sons of bitches. Hope they're as cheerful in a month, Raj Whitehall said, looking down at the map spread over his saddle bow. His hound Horace shifted beneath him from one foot to the other, whining with impatience to be off at a gallop in the crisp fall air. Raj stroked his neck with one gauntleted hand. The commanders were gathered on a knoll, and it gave a wide view over the broad river valley below. The hoarse male chorus of the cavalry troopers sounded up from the fields. The expeditionary force snaked westward through low, rolling hills. Wagons and guns on the road, infantry and battalion columns to either side, and 5 battalions of cavalry off to the flanks. There was very little dust. It had rained yesterday, just enough to lay the ground. The infantry were making good time, rifles over their right shoulders and blanket rolls looped over the left. In the middle of the convoy, the camp followers spread in a magpie turmoil, one element of chaos in the practiced regularity of the column. But they were keeping up too. It was mild but crisp, perfect weather for outdoor work. The leaves of the oaks and maples that carpeted the higher hills had turned to gold and scarlet hues, much like the native vegetation. The soldiers looked like veterans now. Even the ones who hadn't fought with him before this campaign. Even the former squadrones, military captives taken into the civil government's forces after the conquest of the southern territories last year. Their uniforms were dirty and torn. The blue of the tailcoat jackets and the dark maroon of their baggy pants, both the color of the soil. But the weapons were clean and the men ready to fight, which was all that really mattered. "Looks like more rain tonight," Eduardo Poplinich said, shading his eyes and looking north. "Doesn't it ever not rain in this bloody country?" The companions were veterans now, too, his inner circle of commanders. Like a weapon whose hilt is worn with use, shaped to fit the hand that reaches for it in the dark, Eduardo was much more than a governor's grandson these days.
"Only in high summer," Jorge Menez replied. "Rather reminds me of home. There are parts of Keldon County much like this, and the Diva River country up on the northwestern frontier."
He sneezed. The infantry specialist was allergic to dogs, which was why he used a riding steer and why he'd originally chosen the despised foot soldiers for his military career, despite high rank and immense wealth. Now he believed in them with a convert's zeal, and they caught his faith and believed in themselves.
"Good-looking farms," Garen Stainbridge said, biting into an apple. "My oath, but I wouldn't mind getting my hands on some of this countryside."
And Garen's come a long way, too. He'd commanded the 5th Descat before Raj made them his own. Back then, garrison duty boredom had left him with nothing to occupy his time but fiddling the battalion accounts and his hobbies, the saber and the opera, and good-looking youths. There were a good many orchards hereabout, apple and plum and cherry, and vineyards trained high on stakes or to the branches of low mulberry trees. Wheat and corn had been cut and carted, the wheat in thatched ricks in the farmyards, the corn in long rectangular bins still on the cob. Dark brown earth rippled in furrows beneath ox-drawn plows as the fields were made ready for winter grains. Few laborers fled, even when the army passed close by. Word had spread that the eastern invaders ravaged only where resisted, and the earth must be worked, or all would starve next year. Pastures were greener than most of the easterners were used to, grass up to the hocks of the grazing cattle. Half-timbered cottages stood here and there, usually nestled in a grove, with an occasional straggling crossroads village, or a peon settlement next to a blocky stone-built manor house. Many of the manors were empty. The remaining landlords were mostly civilian, and eager to come in and swear allegiance to the civil government. Here and there a mansion stood burnt and empty, ill-considered resistance, or peasant vengeance on fleeing masters. Some of the peons abandoned their plows to come and gape as the great ordered mass of the civil government's army passed, with the starburst fluttering at its head. It had been more than 500 years since that holy flag flew in these lands. Raj reflected ironically that the natives probably thought the 7th Descat Rangers' marching song was a hymn. There was much touching of amulets and kneeling.
"We fuck the whores right through their drawers. We do not care for trifles. We hangs our balls upon the walls and shoots at them with rifles."
"Area's too close to the stalwarts for my liking," Colton Gruder said. His hand stroked the scars on his face, legacy of a colonial shellburst that had killed his younger brother.
"Speaking of which, any news of the Brigadero's garrisons up there?"
"The Ministry of Barbarians came through on that one," Raj said, still not looking up from the map. "The stalwarts are raiding the frontier just as we paid them to, and most of the enemy regulars there are staying. The rest are pulling back southwest toward the Padan River, where they can barge upstream to Carson Barracks." Bribing one set of barbarians to attack another had been a civil government specialty for generations. Cheaper than wars, usually, although there were dangers as well. The brigade had come south long ago, but the stalwarts were only down from the base area a couple of generations. Fierce, treacherous, numerous, and still heathen, not even following the heretical This Earth cult.
"Right," Raj said, rolling up the map. "We'll continue on this line of advance to the Chibut River." He used the map to point west. "At least Plumhas. Mabruste reports it's opened its gate to the first cruisers. Eduardo, I want you to link up with him there,
push on ahead of the column with two batteries and take command. Cross the river and feint toward the Padan at Empirhado. It's a good logical move, and they'll probably believe it. Engage at your discretion, but screen us in any case. The Padan drained most of the central part of the Western Territories, rising in the southern foothills of the Sangre del Espirito Mountains and running northwest along the range, then west and southwest around its northernmost outliers. Empirhado was an important river port, and taking it would cut off the north from the Brigadero capital at Carson Barracks. Actually, Raj went on, we'll cut southeast again, around Zaranique, at the head of the residential gulf, and come straight down on old residents. I want them to come to us, and they'll have to fight for that eventually. It is the ancient capital of the civil government. At the same time, it's accessible by sea up the Blanco River, so we've a secure line of communications to Lion City. Strategic offensive, tactical defensive. Everyone nodded, some making notes. Lion City was a very safe base. Its ruling syndics had tried to resist the civil government army, fearful of brigade retaliation and confident in their city walls. Raj had found an ancient pre-fall passageway under them and led a party to open the gates from within. After the sack, the syndics who'd counseled resistance had been torn to bits, quite literally, by the enraged common folk of the city. The commoners' only hope now was a civil government victory. If the brigade came back, they'd slaughter every man, woman, and child for treason to the general, and for the murder of their betters. Meanwhile, I'm going to keep 5 battalions of cavalry with the main column and send the rest of you out raiding. Round up supplies, liberate the towns, and incidentally, knock down the defenses. We don't want brigaderos occupying them again in our rear. Be alert, messers. There'll probably be more resistance soon. I've furnished a list of objectives of military significance. Gramic, I don't like these roads, the artilleryman cum engineer said. Like most of his branch of service, Gramic Dinelson was a city man from East Residence. Unlike most of the military nobility, Raj Whitehall had never hesitated to use the technical skills that went with that education. They're just graded dirt, and it's clay dirt at that. Much more rain, and it's going to turn into soup. Raj nodded again. Nevertheless, I intend to make at least 20 clicks per day, minimum. Jorge Menez shrugged. My boys will march it, he said, and sneezed, moving a little aside to get upwind of the dogs. I'm surprised we haven't seen more resistance already, he added. We're well beyond the zone Major Claret raided. Raj grinned. A little dactysauroid flew in and whispered in my ear, he said, in the person of the esteemed Revidardo Boyes. He was one of the Ministry of Talkmongers at Carson Barracks, bribed his way out, that the brigade has called a council of war there. Harsh laughter from the circle of companions. The council of war included all male brigade adults and decided the great issues of state in huge conclaves at Carson Barracks, the capital the brigade had built off in the swamps, or to be more accurate, debated the issues at enormous length. To men used to the omnipotent quasi-divine autocracy of the civil government, it was an endless source of amusement. No, it's actually a good move. They have to decide on their leadership before they can do anything. Philip Forker certainly won't. Forker was a mild-tempered scholar, very untypical of the brawling warrior nobility of the brigade. He was also a defeatist who'd been in secret communication with the civil government. So they have to get rid of him and elect a fighting man as general. Of course, they have left it a little late. The troopers below roared out the last verse of their marching song. Much joy we reap by diddlin' sheep in divers nooks and ditches. Nor give we a damn if they be rams. We're hardy sons of bitches. Let's get moving, gentlemen. I expect some warm welcomes on the way to old residence. Compliments to Captain Suarez and Company C to face left on this line, Garen Stainbridge said. He sketched quickly on his notepad and tore off the sheet to hand to the dispatch rider. The man tucked it under his jacket to shelter the drawing from the slow drizzle of rain. Garen raised his binoculars. The lance points of the Brigadero's cuirassiers were clearly visible behind the ridge there, 4,000 meters out into the west. From the way the pennants whipped backward, they were moving briskly. Bit of a risk to spread his front, but the fire of the other company should cover it. Better to stop the flanking movement well out than to simply refuse his flank in place. And one gun, he added. The messenger spurred, and the trumpet sounded. Men moved along the sunken lane to his front, where the main line of the two battalions faced north. A company crawled back and stood, then double-timed west in column of fours. Water spurted up from their boots and squelched away from the gun that followed them, its dogs panting and skidding on the surface of wet earth and yellow leaves as they trundled out of sight to meet the enemy's flanking attack. The remaining men moved west to occupy the vacant space, spreading themselves in response to barked orders. The paws of the colonel's dog squelched too as he rode down the lane. It was barely 9 meters wide, rutted mud flanked on either side by tall maple and whipstick trees. North beyond that was a broad stretch of reaped wheat stubble, with alfalfa showing green between the faded gold of the straw. Beyond that was a line of orchard, and the Brigaderos, those whose bodies weren't scattered across the field between from the first failed rush. That's right, lads, Stainbridge called out as he cantered toward the center of the line, where the standards of the 5th Descat and the 1st Residence Lifeguards flew together beside the main battery. Keep those delectable buttocks close to the earth and pick your targets. The men were prone or kneeling behind the meter-high ridge that marked the sunken lane's northern edge. The trees and the remains of a rail fence gave more cover still. There were a scatter of brass cartridge cases and the lingering stink of sulfur under the wet mud and rotting leaf smell. Most of them had gray cloaks spread over their backs. Lion City had had a warehouse full of them, woven of raw wool with the lanolin still in them, nearly waterproof. Stainbridge had thoughtfully posted a guard on that when the city fell, and lifted enough for all his men and a margin extra. Raindrops glistened on the wool, sliding aside as the men adjusted sights and reloaded. The breech block of a gun clanged open, and the crew pushed it forward until its barrel jutted in alignment with the muzzles of the riflemen's weapons. He drew up beside the banner. Captain Harwich, he went on. Shift a splat gun to the left end of the line, if you please. The commander of the two batteries shouted, and the light weapon jounced off down the trail, the crew pulling on ropes. There was no need to hitch the dog team for a short move, but it followed obediently, dragging the caisson with the reserve ammunition. We could put a mounted company behind the left and countercharge when those lobster backs are stalled, Cabot Claret offered. It was the textbook answer, but Stainbridge shook his head. Fighting barbs with swords, he said, is like fighting a pig by getting down on your hands and knees and biting it. I prefer to keep the rifles on our firing line. We'll see if they come again. They're going to, Barton Foley said emotionlessly. He was peeling an apple with the sharpened inner curve of his hook. Now he sliced off a chunk and offered it. Stainbridge took it, ignoring Cabot Claret's throttled impatience. It was crisper and more tart than the fruit he was used to. Probably the longer winters here, he thought. Cabot Claret probably resented the fact that Barton Foley had started his military career as a protege, boyfriend, actually, of Stainbridge's. Although the battles that had taken the young man's left hand, and the commands he'd held since, made him considerably more than that. Look to your right, Major Claret, Garen said. They may try something there as well. Long lines of helmeted soldiers in gray and black uniforms were coming out of the orchard 3,000 meters to their front. Serried lines, blocks 3 deep and 50 men broad, all along the front, then a gap of several minutes and another wave, but these in company columns.
2,000 in the first wave, he said. 1,000 in column behind. 3,000 all up.
Plus their reserve, Foley noted, peering at the tree line.
Claret snorted. If the barbs are keeping one, he said.
Oh, these are, I should think. This is Hereditary High Colonel Esaku, and
Hereditary Major Gutfried, Foley completed. 3,500 to 4,500 in all, household troops and military vassals.
To the right, a battery commander barked an order. The loader for the guns shoved a two-pronged iron tool into the head of a shell and turned, adjusting the fuse to the distance he was given. Within the explosive head, a perforated brass tube turned within a solid one, exposing a precise length of beechwood-enclosed powder train. Another man worked the lever that dropped the blocking wedge and swung the breech block aside, opening the chamber for the loader to push the shell home. The blocks clattered all along the line, five times repeated. The gunner clipped his lanyard to the release toggle and stood to one side. The rest of the crew skipped out of the path of recoil, already preparing to repeat the cycle, in movements better choreographed than most dances. The battery commander swung his sword down.
Poof, 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 poof.
Five blasts of powder smoke and red light, and the guns bounced backward across the laneway, splattering muddy water to both sides. Crews heaved at their tall wheels to shove them back into battery as the loaders pulled new shells out of the racks and the caissons. The crack of the shells bursting over the enemy followed almost at once. Men died, scythed down from above. Stainbridge winced slightly in sympathy. Overhead shrapnel was any soldier's nightmare, something to which there was no reply. The brigaderos came on, picking up the pace but keeping their alignment. The columns following the troops deployed in line were edging toward his left. He nodded, confirmation of the opposing commander's design. It was a meeting of minds, as intimate as a saber duel or dancing. Closer now, it didn't take long to cover 1,000 meters at the trot. 1,000 seconds, less than 10 minutes. The brigadero's dragoons had fixed their bayonets, and the wet steel glinted dully under the cloudy sky. Their boots were kicking up clots of dark brown soil, ripping holes in the thin cover of the stubble field.
Poof, 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 poof.
More airbursts, and one defective timer that plowed into the dirt and raised a minor mud volcano as the backup contact fuse set it off. Nothing like the squadrones, Stainbridge thought. The barbarians of the southern territories had bunched in a crowded mass, a perfect target. These brigaderos were much better.
Poof, 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 poof.
Powder smoke drifted along the firing line, low to the ground and fog-like under the drizzle. At least the southern territories were dry, he thought. Descott County got colder than this in midwinter, but it was semi-arid.
I make it 1,100 meters, Foley said, getting on for small arms range.
Ready? Stainbridge called.
Officers and non-coms went down the firing line, checking that sights were adjusted.
I wonder how the left flank is making out.
Did ye load hardpoint?
Corporal Robbie Metelgez hissed. The rifleman he addressed swallowed nervously.
Think so, Corp, he said, looking back over his shoulder at the non-com.
Company C were kneeling in a cornfield just back from the crest of a swell of ground. The corn had never been harvested, but cattle and pigs had been turned loose into it. Most of the stalks were broken rather than uprooted, slick and brown with decay and the rain. They formed a tangle waist-high in wavering rows across the lumpy field. Just ahead of the line of troopers was the company commander, also down on one knee, with his signalers, and a bannerman holding the furled unit pennant horizontal to the ground. The field gun and its crew were slightly to the rear.
Work your lever, Metelgez said.
The luckless trooper shoved his thumb into the loop behind the hand grip of his rifle and pushed the lever sharply downward. The action clacked and ejected the shell directly to the rear as the bolt swung down and slightly back. The non-com snatched it out of the air with his right hand, as quick and certain as a trout rising to a fly. There was a hollow drilled back into the pointed tip of the lead bullet.
"You peon-witted dickhead recruity," the corporal said. "Why ain't you in the fucking infantry? You want one of them pig stickers up your arse?"
Hollow point loads often failed to penetrate the body armor of Brigadero's heavy cavalry. He clouted the man alongside the head under his helmet.
"Lord!"
The younger man nodded and reached back to his bandolier. It was on the broad webbing belt that cinched his swallowtail uniform coat, just behind the point of his right hip. The closing flap was buckled back, exposing the staggered rows of cartridges in canvas loops. The outer frame of the container was rigid soroid hide, boiled in wax. But brass corrodes in contact with leather. This time there was a smooth, pointed cap of brass on the lead of the bullet he thumbed home down the grooved ramp on the top of the rifle's bolt. Hunting ammunition for big, thick-skinned soroids, but it did nicely for armor as well.
"Use your brain. It'll save your butt,"
the corporal went on more mildly. He sank back into his place in the ranks, watching the platoon's lieutenant and the company commander. The lieutenant was new since Stern Isle, but he seemed to know his business. The platoon sergeant thought so, at least. They'd both behaved as well as anybody else in that rat fuck in the tunnel. Metelgez smiled, and the young trooper who'd been looking over to him to ask a question swallowed again and looked front, convinced that nothing he could see there would be more frightening than the section leader's face. Metelgez was thinking what he was going to do if, when, he found out who had started the stampede to the rear in the close darkness of the pipe tunnel. There'd been nothing he could do, nothing anyone could do, once it started, except move back or get trampled into a pulp and suffocated when the pipe blocked solid with a jam of flesh. The second cruisers, jumped up squadron barbs, had gone in instead of the fifth Descat, with Messer Raj. The stain on the fifth's honor had been wiped out by their bloodily successful assault on the gates later that night. But Metelgez intended to find out who'd put the stain there in the first place. The fifth had been with Messer Raj since his first campaign, and they'd never run from an enemy. The gunners were rolling their weapon forward the last few meters to the crest of the slight rise, two men on either wheel and three holding up the trail.
"On the word of command," the lieutenant said, watching the captain.
A trumpet sounded, five rising notes and a descant.
"Company? Platoon! Forward!"
120 men stood and took three paces forward. The lieutenant stopped, their arms and swords outstretched to the side in a T-bar to give their units the alignment. To the brigaderos, they appeared over the crest of the dead ground with the suddenness of a jack-in-the-box. 500 meters before them, about a quarter of the brigaderos' column was in view, coming over a slight rise. They rode in a column 6 men broad, expecting action soon. They'd brought the 3-meter lances out of the buckets and were resting the butt ends on the toes of their right boots. The dogs they rode were broad-pawed Newfoundlands, shaggy and massive and black, weighing up to 1,400 pounds each. They needed the bulk and bone to carry men wearing back and breastplate, thigh guards and arm guards of steel, plus sword and lance and firearms and helmet. Their usual role was to charge home into stalwart masses already chopped into fragments by their dragoon comrades' rifle fire. Sometimes the savage footmen absorbed the charge and ate it, like a swarm of lethal bees too numerous for the lancers to swat. More often, the cavalry scattered the stalwarts into fugitives who could be hunted down and slaughtered, as long as the lancers went in boot to boot without the slightest hesitation. It was a style of warfare that had ended in the eastern part of the Midworld Basin 2 centuries ago, when breech-loading firearms became common. The brigaderos were about to learn why. Of course, since there were nearly 1,000 of the cuirassiers, The civil government troops might not survive the lesson either.
Poof.
The field gun recoiled away from the long plume of smoke. The first shell exploded at head height, a dozen yards from the front of the column. Pure serendipity, since the fuses weren't sensitive enough to time that closely. It was canister, a thin-walled head full of lead balls, with a small bursting charge at the rear. The charge stripped the casing of the shell off its load and spread the balls out, but the velocity of the shell itself made them lethal. The first three ranks of the Lancers went down in kicking, howling confusion. The commander of the cuirassier regiment had been standing in his stirrups and raising the triangular three-bar visor of his helmet to see what had popped up to bar his command's way. Three of the half-ounce balls ripped his head off his torso and threw the body in a backward somersault over the cantle of his saddle. Behind him, the balls went over the heads of the rear of the column, protected by the dip in the field in which they rode. The projectile struck the upraised lances instead, the wood of the forward ranks and the foot-long steel heads of those further back and lower down. The sound was like an iron rod being dragged at speed along the largest picket fence in the universe. Lances were smashed out of hands or snapped off like tulips in a hothouse for a dozen ranks back. Men shouted in fear or pain, and dogs barked like muffled thunder. The cuirassier regiment was divided into 10 troops of 80 to 90 men each, commanded by a troop captain and under officers. None of them knew what was happening to the head of the column, but they were all brigade noblemen and anxious to close with the foe. They responded according to their training, the whole mass of Lancers halting and each troop turning to right or left to deploy into line. When the civil government or colonial dragoons deployed for a charge under fire, they did so at a gallop. But the brigaderos were used to fighting men equipped with shotguns and throwing axes, used to having plenty of time to align their lines neatly. Metelgez watched his lieutenant's saber out of the corner of his eye. It swung to the right. He pivoted slightly, taking the general direction from the sword, as his squad did from him. A group of lancers opening out around a swallowtail pennant, borne next to a man whose armor was engraved with silver, wearing a shoulder cape of lustrous hide from some sauroid that secreted iridescent metal into its scales. The corporal picked a target, a lancer next to the leader. No point in shooting the same man twice, and he knew someone wouldn't be able to resist the fancy armor. The rear notch settled behind the bladed foresight, and he lowered his aiming point another few inches. 600 meters. The bullet would be coming down from the top of its arch at quite an angle.
Volley! Fire!
He exhaled and let his forefinger curl slightly, taking up the trigger slack. The strap of the rifle was wound round his left hand twice, held taut with the forestock resting on the knuckles. He might not know who'd fucked up in the tunnel, but at least he was going to get to kill somebody today.
Fire!
Bullets went overhead with an unpleasant rack sound. Down the line from the command group, a trooper slumped backward with his helmet spinning free to land in the mud and the top taken off of his head. He'd been holding two rounds in his lips like cigarettes, with the bases out ready to hand. They followed the helmet, a dull glint of brass through the rain. Garen Stainbridge looked back and forth down the sunken lane. Stretcher bearers, military servants, were hauling men back, crouching to carry them without exposing themselves over the high northern lip of the laneway. Other bearers and soldiers were carrying forward ammunition boxes, ripping the loosened tops off and distributing handfuls to the troopers on the firing line. Ahead, the brigaderos were advancing again, one line running forward and taking cover, while the second fired and stood to charge their clumsy muzzle-loading rifle muskets. He checked. Yes, the company and platoon commanders were dividing their fire, keeping both segments under fire, and not letting the men waste bullets on prone targets.
Hot work, Barton Foley said beside him.
He gave the literal lie to his words by shaking his head and casting a scatter of cold rain from his helmet and chainmail neck flap.
Bloody hell, Stainbridge replied, raising his voice slightly. Fight in the desert and you want rain. Fight in the rain and you want the sun. Some people are never satisfied.
He lit two cigarettes and passed one to the young captain. A lot of the enemy rifle muskets were misfiring. Percussion caps were immune to rain, but paper cartridges were not. Another line of the brigadieros rose to advance, and a crashing stutter of half-platoon volleys met them. At 300 meters, more shots hit than missed, but the remnants came on and stood to fire a return volley of their own. Wounded men screamed and cursed down the lines of the 5th and the lifeguards, but they were protected, all but their heads and shoulders. The enemy were naked. The civil government's rifle was a single-shot breech loader. Not the least of its blessings was that it could be loaded lying down. Off to the east, the firing line was thinner, where Company C had been detached. The 5th was still over strength, but not so much so since Lion City. The splat gun there gave its brack sound, 35 rifle barrels clamped together and fired by a crank. A brigadero's column was caught 600 meters out, as it began the ponderous countermarch they used to get from marching column into fighting line. Seconds later, two field gun shells arrived at the same target, contact fused. They plowed up gouts of mud and toppled men with blast and heavy casing fragments. Stainbridge stepped off his crouching dog and walked down behind the line, the banner by his side. It had a few more bullet holes, but the bannerman kept it aloft in the gathering rain.
"Sir, would you mind inspiring us and where you won't draw fire?"
a sergeant called back to him.
"Inspiration be damned. I'm checking that your leather work is polished," Stainbridge said. A harsh chuckle followed as he strolled back to the center.
"Spirit the things one says under stress," he thought. A runner squelched up, a lifeguardsman.
"Sir," he said to Cabot Claret, "barb movement in the woods, mounted loik."
Stainbridge nodded at the governor's nephew's glance.
"We're holding here," he said. "Take a company, and the other two splat guns."
"Whitehall's toys," Claret said.
"Useful toys. Take them and use them."
Claret nodded and turned, calling out orders. He straddled his dog, and the animal rose, dripping. The rain was coming down harder now, a steady drizzle. Water sizzled on the barrels of the splat guns, and the gunners left their breeches locked open as they hitched the trails to the limbers and wheeled. Men on the far right of the 2nd lifeguard section of the line fired one more volley and fell in behind him, reloading as they jogged. There was a slapping sound, and the 2nd's bannerman gave a deep grunt and slumped in the saddle. Cabot reached out and took the staff, resting the butt on his stirrup iron as the other man toppled.
"See to him," he said. "You men, follow me."
He kept the dog to a steady, quick walk as they moved in squelching unison behind him.
"Spread it out there," Foley said sharply.
The rightmost company of the 5th and the leftmost of the 2nd shifted to fill in the gap, ducking as they moved to keep under cover.
"He's got nerve," Stainbridge murmured. "Still, I'm happier seeing his back than his glowering face."
"I could resent that remark," Foley said, sotto voce. Aloud,
"Lieutenant, they're clumping to your left. Direct the fire, if you please."
"Fire!"
Metelgez straightened from his crouch and fired. The armory rifle punished his shoulder. The barrel fouled from all the rounds he'd put through it this afternoon. This was the 5th charge, and looked to be the worst yet. 100 yards to the front, dogs went over, and men died. They were close enough that he could hear the flat smacking of bullets hitting flesh, and the sharper p'tung of impacts on armor. He worked the lever and snatched a round he was holding between the fingers of his left hand, thumbing at home.
"Here they come," he snarled.
The brigaderos were getting smarter. They'd dismounted some of their men behind the ridge over there to use their rifles for a base of fire. The commander of Company C had backed his troopers half a dozen paces so that they could load crouching and pop up to fire. But they were still losing men. The enemy were also still trying to charge home. Expensive, but although they might win a firefight, they couldn't win it in time to affect the main action half a click away. And the Lancers had been supposed to sweep down on the flank of the 5th's position. Below, in the slight swale between the low ridges, the Lancers came on in clumps and as stragglers. Their dogs' feet were balls of sticky mud, and the corn stalks there had been trampled into a slippery mass that sent some riders skidding in disastrous flailing tumbles, even if the bullets missed them. More came on, though, laboring up the slope.
Fire!
The corporal fired again. A ragged volley crashed out around him, the muzzle blasts deafening, particularly the one from the man behind, whose muzzle was nearly in his ear.
Watch your dressing, you dickhead,
he screamed, jerking at his lever. And the man shuffled a few steps right. At least the rifle wasn't jamming. There was some benefit to the cold rain that was hissing down into his eyes. He could see the dogs snarling, and the men behind their visors. Mud flew chest high on the dogs as they came closer at a lumbering gallop.
Fire!
More died, and half a dozen turned back. Some as their dogs bolted to the rear, despite sawing hands on the reins and the pressure of bridle levers on their cheeks. The rest came on, those who still had lances leveling them. The shafts were tapered and smooth, save for a grapefruit-sized wooden ball just in front of the hand grip. The heads were straight-sided knives, a foot long, honed and deadly, with steel lappets another 2 feet down the shaft on either side. Metelgus's fingers had to hunt for a second to find a cartridge in his bandolier. The upper rows were empty. He clicked it home just as the straggling charge reached the civil government line. The lieutenant pirouetted aside from a point like a matador in the arena. His saber slashed down on the shaft behind the protective steel splints that ran back from the head, and the razor edges tumbled. He let the motion spin him in place and shot the rider in the back point blank with a revolver in his left hand. Metelgez had lost interest in any lance but the one pointed at his chest. His lever clicked home when it was only a couple of meters away. The corporal threw himself on his back in blind instinct, falling with a thump as the steel dipped. It passed a hand's breadth over his head, and he shot with the butt of his rifle pressed to the earth by his side. The bullet creased the Newfoundland's neck, cutting a red streak through the muddy black fur. The animal reared and then lunged, the huge jaws gaping for his face in a graveyard reek of rotting meat. Metelgez screamed and flung up his rifle. The dog shrieked too when its jaws closed on 2 feet of bayonet. The weapon jerked out of the desk cutter's hands, and the mud sucked at his back. The brigadero was standing in his stirrups, shouting as he shortened the lance to stab straight down from his rearing mount. The young trooper Metelgez had disciplined for misloading stepped up on the other side and fired with the bayonet touching the brigadero's armored torso. It didn't matter what he had up the spout at that range. The lancer pitched out of the saddle as the bullet punched in under his short ribs. The armor served only to flatten it before it buzzsawed up through liver, lungs, and heart to lodge under his opposite shoulder. Blood shot out of his nose and mouth. He was dead before his corpse hit the ground with a clank of steel. The dog was very much alive, its huge paws stamped down on either side of the recumbent desk cutter. They were furnished with claws and pads rather than a grazing animal's hoof, but they would still smash his ribs out through his spine if they landed. The great loose jowled jaws were open as the beast shook its head in agony, splattering rainwater and blood from its cut tongue. The trooper shouted and drove his bayonet toward its neck as the fangs turned toward the man on the ground. The human's attack turned into a stumbling retreat as the dog whirled and snapped, the sound of its jaws like wood slapping on wood. Metelgez remembered his pistol. Most of the troopers had strapped the new weapons to holsters at their saddle bows. They were supposed to be for mounted melees. He'd stuffed his down the top of his riding boot when they dismounted on impulse. Now he snatched it free and blazed away at the furry body above him, into the belly rear of the saddle's girth. The dog hunched up in the middle and ran.
its rear paws just missing him as it staggered a dozen paces and fell thrashing.
Fastardos, he wheezed,
picking up a dead man's rifle and loading as he rolled erect. The brigaderos were retreating across the swale, many of them on foot. Dogs were bigger targets than men.
Bastards!
Matelgez fired, reloaded, fired again.
Bastards!
Shots crackled out all down Company C's line, then the beginnings of volley fire. It slammed into the retreating men, killing nearly as many as had died in the attack before they made it back to the dead ground behind their starting point. The field gun elevated and began dropping shells behind the ridge. The gunners and half a dozen troopers as well, slipping and sliding in the muck as they ran it back up the slight rise until the muzzle showed. Return fire was coming in as well. Retreat unmasked the civil government line to the brigaderos across the swale. Matelgez went back to one knee as the mini bullets crackled overhead and jerked the trooper beside him by the tail of his jacket.
Get your head down, you fool, he growled, looking around.
Not far away, a man writhed with a broken-off lance through his gut, whimpering and pulling at the shaft. It jerked, but the steel was lodged in his pelvis, far beyond the strength of blood-slippery hands to extract. Another fumbled at his belt for a cord to make a tourniquet. His arm was off above the elbow. The blood jetted more slowly as the man toppled over. Matelgez knew there was nothing anyone could do for either of the poor bastards. When it was your time, it was time, and he was very glad it hadn't been his.
Kid,
he went on, as the young man obediently dropped to one knee and looked at him apprehensively.
Kid, you're all right.
Will the uns be back then, Corp? He asked.
Matelgez wiped rain and blood out of his eyes. None of the blood his, thank the spirit.
Now, he rasped.
The low ground ahead of him was thick with corpses of armored men and dogs, particularly in front of the company pennant. The brigaderos had clumped there, driving for the center, and also for the gun, meeting point-blank blasts of case shot.
Now they won't be back.
He looked up and down the line.
Dressin',
he barked sharply. What was left of his section moved to maintain their line. Matelgez grinned, an expression much like that the Lancer's dog had worn when it lunged for his life.
Hoi, barbs,
he shouted at the distant enemy.
Got any messages for your wives? We'll be seeing them afore you do.
Cabot Claret caught the bayonet on his sword. It was a socket bayonet, offset from a sleeve around the muzzle, so that the musket could be loaded and rammed while it was fixed. Metal grated on metal. He fired into the brigadero's body beneath their linked arms. The man pitched backward as the eight-shaped wadcutter bullet put a small hole in his stomach and a much larger one in his back.
Forward,
the governor's nephew said.
Vittoria o muerte,
the motto of the lifeguards. Or victory and death. But nothing came free.
Brap!
The splat gun fired from not far behind to his right. Bullets sprayed down the aisles between the trees. This was a planted oak wood, regular as a chessboard. About 60 or 70 years old from the size of the trees, and regularly thinned as they grew. Water dripped down from the bare branches. Dim figures in gray and black uniforms were running back. A few paused to reload behind trees, but they were only protected from directly ahead. Lifeguardsmen strung out to either side picked them off, mostly before they could complete the cumbersome process. Men flanked him as he walked forward, the new bannerman holding the battalion flag. The company commander was out on the right flank with the other splat gun. He could hear it firing, trundled forward like the one with him to support the advance. Men walked on either side of him, reloading as they dodged the trees. They were cheering as they shot. The platoon commanders turned and flung out arms and swords to remind them to keep their line.
Runner,
Cabot said.
To Colonel Stainbridge. Enemy were advancing in column on our right flank. I've driven them back and will shortly take them in enfilade all the way back to their original start line.
The splat guns were useful. It took less than 10 seconds to replace each iron plate with 35 rounds in it, better than 300 rounds a minute. With them and 100-odd riflemen, he would shortly be in a position to rake the front of the Brigadero's firing line from the right side and chop up any reserves they still held in the orchard. Let that Marhicone see how a claret managed a battle by the spirit.
So we moved forward and caught them on the other side of the orchard as they tried to break contact, Stainbridge said. Cut them up nicely, then pursued mounted, stopping occasionally to shoot them up again. They retreated to a large fortified manor house, which burned quite spectacularly when we shelled it, rain or no. The outbuildings had some very useful supplies, which will be arriving shortly at oxwagon pace, along with the non-combatants. Major Claret, he went on, led the right wing with skill and dash.
Raj nodded to the younger officer.
The supplies will be useful, he said. Difficult to get enough in when we're moving at speed.
He inclined his head down slope. Most of the troops were trudging by with their rifles slung muzzle down. Their boots had churned the fields on either side of the road into glutinous masses. Some of them were wearing local peasant moccasins. The thick mud rotted the thread out of issue boots and sucked off the soles. Further out, the cavalry plodded on, stopping occasionally to scrape balls of mud off their mounts' feet. The dogs whined and dragged, wanting to stop and groom. On the roadway itself, men, infantry, and military servants, with gunners acting as foremen, labored in mud even deeper, laying a corduroy surface of logs and beams. As the officers watched, a gun team came up with its draft chain looped around a hitch of fresh-cut logs. They rumbled down the slope to general curses as men dodged the timber.
I hope, Raj went on, that you kept me some Brigadero's prisoners of rank. We need more information about what's happening at Carson Barracks.
Chapter 3. A hereditary officer from just west of the Walladevere River was speaking.
A dozen farms and a village burned. My manor looted. Only by the grace of the spirit of man of this earth and the intervention of the merciful avatars did I and my household escape the devil Whitehall. What does his mightiness intend to do about it?
The hall of audience was lit by scores of tapers in iron sconces, above the racked battle lasers of antiquity. They cast unrestful shadow across the crowd that packed it, nearly 1,000 men. Light glittered restlessly from sword hilts, from the jeweled hair clasp of one lord or the platinum beads on the jacket fringe of another. The air was cold and dank with the autumn rains that fell outside, but it smelled powerfully of soroid fat candles and male sweat. An inarticulate growl rose from the crowd. These were each powerful men in their own right, nobles who commanded broad acres and hundreds of household troops. They're like crowded Carson barracks, filling housing blocks that usually echoed emptily at this time of year. The petty squires and military vassals and freeholders who had come as well camped in the streets. Right now they filled the vast parade square outside the palace. Crowd noise came through the stone walls like an angry hum, occasionally breaking into a chant. Fight, fight, fight. General Forker rose from the seat to reply. The light glittered coldly on the engraved silver of his ceremonial armor and on the vestments of the sissips and counselors grouped around his throne.
We have suffered grievously with the sufferings of our subjects, he began.
A snarl rose from the crowd, and he swallowed nervously as he continued.
That is why we have summoned you, my lords, to share your counsel with us. Our diplomacy at least delayed this attack, and now the rains are upon us and winter comes on. We will have ample time to prepare.
Another lord stalked into the speaker's position on the floor below the seat and just outside the line of lifeguards.
We've had time. Stern Isle fell 5 months ago, he bit out. All we did was to throw High Colonel Stresman and his men into Lion City. Just enough to hurt us if they were lost, and not enough to halt the enemy. Now Stresman and his men are dead. Lord of men, he went on, his tone cold. You may not wish to campaign in winter, but the enemy don't seem to share your delicate sensibilities. Whitehall is over the Walla de Vere, and his men have been sighted not 3 days' ride from Empirado.
A roar swelled across the hall. The banners hanging from the rafters quivered.
Rumors! Truth! The noble shouted back. This is no raid, no border war for a province or an indemnity. The civvies mean to grind us into dust the way they did the squadron. Kill us and take our lands, throw down our holy church, and enslave our women and children. They're coming, and the natives have already risen in half a dozen provinces.
A ripple of horror went through the hall. It was 600 years since the brigade came down out of the base area and conquered the Spaniel-speaking natives of the civil government's western territories. But the peoples were still distinct in blood and language and faith, and the natives were overwhelmingly in the majority. Like the civil government, they followed the cult of the spirit of Man of the Stars rather than of this earth, as the brigade and its cousins did. The nobleman turned his back on the seat, a breach of protocol that stunned the watchers into silence.
We need a fighting man to lead us. Not this book reader who's plotting with the enemy behind our backs. I move for impeachment.
Forker's face was working with rage and a trapped beast fear. He forced his voice, turning it high and shrill.
You are out of order. Arrest that man.
The guard started forward, but a score of nobles grouped around the speaker drew their swords. The edges threw the light back as the heavy blades rose warningly.
I am not out of order, the noble replied. As hereditary High Major, I have the right to call for impeachment before this assembly. I, Hereditary Brigade Colonel Ingrid Manfrond, second the impeachment.
Another man stepped into the speaker's circle, thick-set and muscular and grizzled,
and place my name in nomination for the position of General of the Brigade. You, Forker hissed, you're not even of the House of Amelson. Collateral branch, Ingrid said. But tomorrow I...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.